Steve Wozniak, along with Steve Jobs, co-founded Apple. Wozniak, an electronics engineer, programmer, and philanthropist, designed and developed the Apple I in 1976, which became the computer that launched Apple. He designed the Apple II in 1977, known as one of the first highly successful mass-produced microcomputers. He also had a major influence over the initial development of the original Apple Macintosh, which Jobs took over following Wozniak's brief departure from the company due to an airplane accident. After leaving Apple in 1985 for good, Wozniak pursued several other business and philanthropic ventures, focusing largely on technology in K-12 schools. Steve Wozniak talks about his life and technology in this address at Miami University.
Thank you all for giving up your time tonight and being here. I go back. When I was a child, you know, your early inspirations, who you're going to be in life, sometimes start when you're young and often in your family. And my father was an electrical engineer. He never pushed, this is what you should be, this is what you should be. Never pushed his values on us. I'm the only one in the family. I liked what he did. I liked watching him work out formulas on papers in the house, going down to where he worked and seeing signals on a TV set screen. And I wanted to be an electrical engineer. I started studying some of the math behind it. I read a book. You know what? When you get an interest in something and you get motivated, it's often more important than knowledge. The book was about a hero who was a ham radio operator, and with his friends, they could tap out messages to another city, to, Morse code messages to another state. And at the end of the book, it said, you can order this equipment and become a ham radio operator. Okay, I was like 9 years old, and you can't learn to drive a car at 9 years old, but you can become a ham radio operator. You have to learn a lot of mathematics of electronics parts. So I got into it, and I decided I wanted to be an engineer, and I asked my father, what do engineers do? Oh, engineers design things like buildings and bridges and washing machines. And our great-grandparents had to wash clothes by hand, you know, and rinse it out. And I thought, oh my gosh, we engineers, I want to be an engineer and make life easier for people, make all these nice appliances for the home. And my father said, you know, and someday, if life gets easier, we won't have to work as hard. Maybe we'll only have to work 4 days a week. Well, today in Silicon Valley, it takes two people working full-time jobs just to own a home. And back then, it was just one person even had to work. So we didn't get our four-day work week yet, and it got kind of intense. But I decided to be an engineer. I got my ham radio license, learned a lot of mathematics, and then I stumbled upon a journal in the hall closet. Computers were big, immense things that you saw on television. They were in big companies, maybe. They were in the military. They were in little places called research, whatever that was. And I was a young kid, you know, 9 years old, 10 years old. I discovered this journal. It started explaining how computers operated on zeros and ones, and it taught you how to add numbers made up of zeros and ones. And I said, wait a minute, that's no harder for a nine-year-old than anything we've ever learned in school. There's no complicated mathematics. And I learned about little logic gates that make tiny decisions, like a light switch. Up is on, down is off. Those kind of simple decisions. And you could combine a lot of them together and get something that would actually add these ones and zeros. These articles were so incredible to me in this journal made for engineers. There were no books in a bookstore. I would go down to Kepler's scientific bookstore near Stanford in Palo Alto, and they had no books touching on computer subjects. And this is, I fell in love with this, and I knew it would be the passion for my life. There were TV screens where every little dot that was a white or black was a one or a zero, and a scanning ray could write them and read them and rewrite them and keep the pattern. Whoa, this was incredible stuff to learn. I felt special. You don't learn this in school. Nobody else in my school has this. Nobody else in my school had a ham radio license. Heck, the first time I got my picture on the front page of the local newspaper, I went to an event with my mom, and it was for, and I pulled out a piece of paper and said, ham radio operators of Sarah School unanimously support Richard Nixon for governor. Flash, 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 all the press pictures, and the front of the newspaper, San Jose Mercury, said, Steve Wozniak representing a school group. They didn't get the joke. All my life, I love it when I tell jokes, but somebody interprets it like it's real. So here I am. I know I love computers, and I'm trying to learn what a real computer is. I did science fair projects with hundreds of parts and hundreds of wires hooked together that would play tic-tac-toe and never lose in sixth grade. And by eighth grade, you could flip all these switches like you see on the old computer displays, and you could add numbers computer style and subtract them. And I knew all the stuff, but I didn't know really a computer. There were no books on it. In high school, I was so advanced in electronics. I mean, I could build little circuits that make tones, and I could do everything, and I kind of knew it all already. And our teacher saw that I would just play pranks on other students, but he had relations with industry. Education was not confined to the high school borders. He got industry to donate parts to the class. He did clever ways to build up test equipment at low cost over the years, so we had better equipment than any local college. But he took people like me every year, and he wound up getting us in with engineers in other companies. I got to go down to Sylvania in Sunnyvale once a week and program this thing called a computer. I had to learn some programming language. My first program that was real was the Knight's Tour of Chess. I played chess, and it bounced a knight piece around the chessboard, doing the proper moves, and hit every square exactly once, and no square twice. No answers came out from the computer. No answers came out. I studied my program. It was working exactly right. It took me a couple of weeks, and then I figured out that my computer was going to get every possible solution in 10 to the 27th years, much longer than our universe has been here. What that told me, that was a shock. I thought I could do anything. I had infinite power with a computer that could do 1,000,000 things a second. How fast can a human being even count numbers? 1,000,000 things a second. And now I realize even if it did 1 billion, 1 trillion, whatever, it couldn't solve this problem. That problem is solvable by a human brain with intuition, with ideas and approaches to solving it. It's not solvable by the raw speed of a computer. All my life I was going to continue to kind of compare the brain to computers. Next, I was down at that company programming the computer, and I saw a booklet on a desk. It was called the Small Computer Handbook, about a smaller size computer, something, you know, the size of a toaster oven, that had been made by Digital Equipment Corporation, the PDPA computer. Oh my gosh, I said, that manual, that's about a computer? They said, you could have it if you want. They let me take the manual with me. I went home and studied it. It described the insides of a computer, storage places, combinations of ones and zeros that would tell it to add numbers or store them somewhere in memory. And then I said, whoa, I don't know. This wasn't an assignment for school. I just said, I wonder if I could design a computer on paper. And I was in high school. I spent many long weekends struggling to build up those little tiny building block pieces called logic gates on chips. If I could design it on paper and make a computer. And I finally got close, and I was kind of proud of myself, you know? No reason to do it. No grades, no recognition, nobody else did it. I was just shy, I was a social outsider, a geek in school. So I had lots of time to do this, and I loved it. And finally, new chip manual came out. And I looked at the new chips. Can I design that computer with these chips? And I got better and better. Every weekend, I would sit down in my room at home, and I would close my door all alone. I would sit on paper and try to figure out how to design computers. Totally self-taught. It's the best way to learn something. You struggle, and it takes longer to learn, but you learn it so deeply. And then I started redesigning this every single computer in the world that I could get a manual for. And the way, how would I get computer manuals? They weren't in stores, I said. Ah, the top physics research place in the world right now is probably considered CERN, you know, in Switzerland and France. But back then, it was Stanford Linear Accelerator Center in Palo Alto. And I found out I could drive over on a Sunday and just drive in, and I could find the main building, and the smartest people in the world don't lock doors. A universal truth. I could go in, and I could find computer magazines and fill out cards and have them send me manuals. I would get manuals for IBM computers, digital equipment computers, Varian computers, Hewlett-Packard computers, and every weekend I'd sit down in my room and design that computer. And then I started designing them over and over, trying to make my designs better. Fewer parts to me was better. Fewer chips, and then later, no, if you use a bigger chip that's more complex, that might count as two chips. And so I finally came up with different formulas. The smaller size you can make it, the better your design. And I started coming up with tricks in my head and ways to generate new tricks. I was also the math star in my schools, winning the math award, so I was good at thinking. And I came up with tricks that I knew that wouldn't be in any book ever, and ways to generate new tricks that were in no books. So I knew that there might be other people as good as me in the world, engineers at designing computers, but none better. And I didn't think I would ever design computers in my life. Why? I was going to be an engineer. Engineers did strong mathematics, calculations to make TVs work, differential calculus designs, and they didn't do. I didn't think engineers made computers. They made televisions and radios and radars and things like that. I just thought computers were made in these strange places called research, but I loved doing it. First year of college, introduction to computers, graduate course, I got an A+. By writing every single program I could think of writing, I ran our class 5 times over budget. More than out-of-state tuition, a lot of money, like $50,000 today. Whoa, that was a little scary. I had a great fun time and learned a lot at that school, but didn't try to go back there. I was afraid they would charge me. My parents couldn't afford it. 2 years of college, and then what do? I didn't want to burden my parents with the cost of a 4-year college, Berkeley. So I went to work for 1 year, programming for a year, for a company, nearby company, building a computer. I walked in a door by accident, discovered what they were doing, applied for a job, and got it. And while I was at that company, earning money for my 3rd year of college, an engineer heard that I could design computers. And I said, yeah, I love designing them. And he said, well, did you ever build one? I said, no, I could never afford a single chip. No money. He said, I can get you chips. I have connections with chip companies. I went home, designed a computer, built this computer up, and it was called the Cream Soda Computer. Bill Fernandes and I built it, and we would drink cream soda while we were building. Bill said, you should meet this other guy from our high school, Steve Jobs, because he plays pranks at the school too. I was well known as a prank player. Steve Jobs had played some pranks, and he was into electronics, although he wasn't really a designer like I was. But we met and we got along. We're talking about life philosophies, things going on back in Vietnam War days and the like, the counterculture in San Francisco. Steve looking for a lot of religion. Me sort of having found who I was, have my feet well on the floor because I was older. Took Steve to my house that first night, showed him the Bob Dylan albums, the liner notes, the words to songs. And we formed a strong friendship, and we would go to those songs together and talk about life. This was Steve Jobs Zero, leading up to Apple 5 years later. Over those 5 years, about once a year, Steve would come into town, see something I had designed for fun, and he would always be able to get money for it. He was a salesman. He had worked in surplus electronics sales even, and he would turn my designs into hundreds of dollars for us, or thousands even, and this was just a great relationship we had. Okay, eventually came time the Homebrew Computer Club, a club of people, not necessarily executives, not necessarily money people, some Stanford professors and the like. All the big computer companies said little small computers based on a new chip called the microprocessor weren't worth anything. We said once people have computers, we're going to communicate, we're going to educate, we're going to be important as geeks that understand computers, we're going to be important. And oh my gosh, I want to be a part of this. Back in high school, I told my father, someday I am going to own a 4K computer. And he said, it costs as much as a house. And I was stunned, so I said, I'll live in an apartment. Threw down the gauntlet. I was going to have a computer, and I was so close. I was working on the hottest products of the time for Hewlett-Packard, handheld scientific calculators. I didn't have a college degree, but they had interviewed me and hired me on the spot. And I was familiar with all the parts and the prices and how they could be hooked together, and finally saw the formula. It sort of happened right around then, the right kind of parts that made a 4K computer affordable. Why 4K? Without a 4K computer in those days, you could not write a computer program. You couldn't write a computer program that was really useful and easy and solve puzzles and problems and things like that. So that set me on the way. I wanted to give other people a device so that they could sit down and write programs to solve problems of the world, solve problems they had on their own, to solve puzzles and play games. Games was so ultimately important. We had to have games in our life. I believed in fun. I'd come up with my formula for happiness. H equals S minus F. Happiness equals smiles minus frowns. In a later year, I modified it to H equals F cubed. H equals food, fun, and friends, where food is necessities of life, like clothing. And H equals three Fs, and I said that to when I was being put in my high school hall of fame, and the students started laughing. Oh, and I had to go on the microphone, and embarrassingly, I had to say, well, there might be a fourth F. So anyway, I wanted to build a product that would make men people who knew how to use a computer, who wanted to learn programming, with more power, superpower, more power than people were supposed to have. And I gave away my design for free to the people at the club. Public domain. Steve Jobs didn't know it existed, but he came into town and he saw it and he said, one, and said, let's start a company to build a little piece that will help them build your computer. He wasn't yet a computer company guy. He was a salesman of parts. He'd done that a lot in his life. The very first Apple I computer, I had to buy it myself for $300 and give it to a woman who would take it into schools. I believed that much in education. In sixth grade, I told my dad, I'm going to be an engineer first, but it's fifth grade teacher second. Anyway, we got started with such a great product, it was going to be all of Apple's revenues for the first 10 years of Apple. This Apple II computer that I owned totally, I conceived it, I built it, I prototyped it. Steve Jobs would turn it into a product, a physical shape, in marketing, and words, and press, and I would just hide in the laboratory and keep inventing things. This computer was the first time ever that arcade games were color. It was the first time ever that arcade games were software. A 9-year-old kid could write a good game with moving colors on a screen in one day, where normally with hardware designs of the past, at Atari, it would take a skilled engineer a year to design a game.
Upon leaving Apple as a day-to-day employee, Wozniak chose to never remove himself from the original employee list and continued to represent the company at events or in interviews, receiving a stipend from the company, an estimated $120,000 per year. He remained an Apple shareholder and maintained friendly acquaintance with Steve Jobs until Jobs' death in October of 2011.